and security aspects. So leaving the decentralization to the parent chains, then they really should be able to have high throughput and but still secure. You obviously don't want your users to have any risk in using your application. But additionally, we want to focus on them being flexible and also extensible. So while they are narrowly focused in implementation, they are very broad and flexible in the framework. So from the onset, you should be able to do a lot of things with them, be able to apply them to a lot of situations, a lot of use cases, but then be able to lock down and really define what that use case is. And that's how we envision these application-specific blockchains. So one last slide. So as I said, applicable to a wide array of use cases, or at least we envision. And particularly our implementation runs in the Java virtual machine. So we're, it could be used in things in low power computing devices. So there really is for Internet of Things, and you can really, lock down. You don't want your computing device on your cow to be hacked, and maybe the cow is no longer yours, right? So also, these are public or private, and what I mean by that, just to for definition's sake, is public, meaning that not in the sense of open or closed source, but so far as public being that all transaction data is available in the network. Everyone, any interaction that has to happen is open and everyone sees all parts of the transaction. Whereas private being some parts of the transaction can be hidden, and then ultimately the result of the transaction is published to the chain and available for the public to see. So both implementations could be used. And then further, one last exposition is that the permission versus permissionless argument. So there's been a lot of work done, specifically developing permissioned blockchains where you rigorously define the members of the network and who can actually access things and who can transact. But those sorts of architectures are very limiting in scope insofar as you have to well define who the grouping of people and of people that can actually do this, and they have to be all of a similar size insofar as they have to have similar interests, right? It's very hard for you to, across a very large network of users and organizations and suppliers, to really try to integrate them all and get them to agree on one standard of how you're gonna do this and have it unwieldy, right? So we are gonna focus here on what we're gonna talk on as Nick goes further on the permissionless architecture, whereby anyone can join, it's open. However, you can still have this private implementation. And really, by not trying to mitigate security or trying to gain security through just restricting who can have access, you from the outset say, I'm going to let everyone have access, and I'm going to build my security around that. As I said, we're working on this sort of project at Topple. We've termed it Project Edda, which is a application-specific permissionless blockchain. We really aim for this to be an out-of-the-box solution that organizations can kind of just download from us, define their use case, and then be ready for it to be implemented. And now I'm gonna hand it off to Nick, who's gonna expand on how we built this and some of the nitty-gritty details of what needs to be implemented in a blockchain, which is kind of taken care of so that you can think about your use case and not just, how do I implement a blockchain and those sorts of problems.
All right, thank you very much, Jim. All right, so yes, that was a great introduction to our motivations behind actually creating this framework in the first place. I would like to get more into the specifications of what actually goes into making a single use or single application blockchain. So, implementation details. There's a few key pieces I want to go over first about pretty much any blockchain. So, you have your node client. You have individual nodes that you're running yourself. They're interacting, communicating with each each other to actually form the network behind the blockchain. You have your virtual machine running smart contracts, running the transactions, some sort of runtime environment to actually create those transactions within smart contracts specifically. Consensus protocol to handle the validation and finalizing of the transactions. A ledger, which is the actual core blockchain technology itself, the Merkle roots and trees, the idea of behind Bitcoin specifically, and then every blockchain. And something a little bit different, an external communication protocol. So this is building on the layer two part, where you're now taking a blockchain from the most base level and building in interoperability either with other blockchains or some sort of scalability solution on top of the existing blockchain to give it a little bit more throughput, transaction speed, whatever your aim is. So I'm not really here to talk about the ledger part, since that's pretty much a core piece that's in any blockchain. It doesn't really change too much. Everybody knows Merkle roots well. If you don't know Merkle roots from a technical standpoint, we're not really going to get into that at this point in time. That's more of just a more basic thing. We're going to get into all the other details that are more specific to our blockchain. So no client VM. So yes, our actual client is built in Scala entirely. That gives us a lot of options when it comes to modularity and concurrency. Scala is a great language. Functional languages in general are great. They pair very well with blockchain technologies. Also, since it's in Scala, that means it's built on the JVM, which is a wonderful thing when it comes to certain applications, like if you want to run it on IoT devices, mobile devices, embedded systems, you can run it practically anywhere. There is a little bit of overhead just for starting up the JVM, but once it's running, it's a very good system to have. Our framework specifically integrates NASHORN. NASHORN is a JavaScript runtime environment, and that is what we are writing our smart contracts in. It's a very nice integrated solution that's built by Oracle. Is currently in talks of being deprecated, but there's GraalVM and there's other solutions available for if NASHORN gets deprecated. So there's always solutions in the JVM, including other languages that you can build on top. So the smart contracts themselves, as I said, JavaScript. So the runtime environment itself is sandboxed. So it's running in the same JVM that the Scala blockchain is running, and they're both running concurrently alongside each other. But they are completely sandboxed from each other. So there's no leaks, there's no holes, there's no way for these two systems to actually have like a cross-site type attack, where you can write something in the JavaScript that could actually run malicious code through the blockchain or through the actual client itself. We are building in an extensible Esprima parser. Esprima is actually a type of parser. It builds AST. To keep it on a high level, basically it parses the JavaScript and you can serialize and rebuild the functions at the node level. So you can build in a lot of complex logic into this parser. So instead of having to build opcodes or some sort of system in place to limit the architecture of the smart contracts at a deep level, you can actually build it at a very high level through parsers. So that's a very nice thing when you want to build something for a single application, because you can really restrict and batten down the behavior of these smart contracts for specific use cases. And when I go to the functional demonstration, we'll go through one of those use cases that Topple's using specifically. So our consensus protocol. So Eta and Topple are both implementing the Ouroboros protocol. For those not familiar, as Jim mentions and Chris mentions, we built off of the Scorex 2.0 framework. So a little bit of history. There was a man, Charles Hoskinson. He was a part of Ethereum. left formed a group called IOHK. It was a research foundation based out of Hong Kong. Before they created Cardano, they created a framework called ScoreX, written in Scala. And that is what we were building on top of. So they basically built, you know, the very beginnings of some, you know, naive proof of stake type implementation of a blockchain. It's a highly modular, well-architected piece of code because it was all built, you know, in an academic setting by a lot of research. So they also built Ouroboros on top of this for Cardano specifically. So it's a peer-reviewed paper. It's gone through the rounds. You know, it's been presented at conferences. It is a highly researched product. So according to the paper and according to Charles Hoskinson and the guys at IOHK, it is a provably secure proof-of-stake implementation. So that by using VRFs, which are verifiably random functions, you can actually prove that there is a pseudo-random number generation scheme that is picking these slot leaders every single time. And by slot leaders, instead of having some person just getting lucky by hashing the right hash every single time, or having block producers picked through a delegation scheme, there's actually an algorithm called follow the Satoshi algorithm, where basically you're generating a random number, a pseudo-random number every time, and it's picking somebody in the system, somebody that's staking in the system every single time at a completely random function. It also implements a nice thing called epochs. So if you're familiar with Casper, what they're doing in Ethereum, Casper is going to be a hybridized solution. It's not just proof of stake. So there'll be proof of work up until, I believe it's the 50th block, and then they will wrap it all up in an epoch. And what that means is basically a majority votes comes to consensus and says everything that happens in those last 50 blocks or so, in Ouroboros' case, it's 100 blocks, everything that happens, we are going to basically lock that down and finalize everything that happened in every single one of those blocks and move on from there. So it's a very secure way of having finality. So Ouroboros Genesis is the third generation of Ouroboros. So there was Ouroboros, Ouroboros Prowse, and now Ouroboros Genesis. So we are going to implement the third generation. And what that actually means is you can generate a full chain from the Genesis block without check-ins. So normally in a proof-of-work scheme, when you do chain selection, you just pick, it's very simple, you just pick the longest chain in the network, because proof-of-work has a time constraint, and due to that time constraint, you can just pick the longest one because you know that the most amount of time has been spent to get that chain. Now, proof of stake, that's not necessarily true. So it implements a heuristic where basically you divide the chain up into chunks, and by checking in at certain points that you're checking yourself, not with other nodes in the system, you can actually determine if you're on the right chain due to the density of the blocks being mined in the system. So the last key point was external communications protocol. So this is the part where you talk about like side channels or lightning networks or side chains. So in our case, we're going to be implementing side chains. So because we're operating in a trustless environment, we want to be able to have people coming in and leaving in a non-permission setting. Basically what that means is, we want to try and limit or prevent things like hard forks or people having to make tough decisions about core architecture pieces. So if you build in sidechains, you build in a lot of interoperability, you can implement, you know, different behaviors for different asset classes and tokens, and you can have them existing alongside your core architecture. So you can actually take, you know, the ETA framework and you build multiple blockchains side by side, and they can interopt with each other seamlessly, but have completely different architectures and parsers and smart contract systems, while also having some sort of core piece that can be passed in between each other. So those are all the core pieces of the actual framework itself, the blockchain. So now, the real reason we're here, the real reason Alexi sent me all the way from Austin, Texas to come here is to talk about Scala, of course. So I'm not here to actually try and convince anybody to use Scala in their next project or evangelize Scala for the next generation of programmers or anything like that. I'm really more here to convince you that if you already are thinking about using Scala or functional programming, that this is actually a very good choice, especially when it comes to blockchain specifically. So one of the nice things about functional programming is you can write very concise code. You can take things that, especially when it comes to like iterations, recursives, loops, things like that, you can condense it down into single lines of code usually. This makes for a lot of things easier to test, easier to reason about, just generally better for coming in after somebody else's written code or something like that, which if you're trying to implement new code on top of an existing framework is a very important thing, because you have to spend time reading through the code itself, reading through the source code, and trying to reason about it in the first place. So Scala also has a lot of architectural things that are built in that increase modularity. So two of the key things I particularly like are case classes and pattern matching. So case classes build on top of regular classes where you can implement pattern matching on top of them. So you can do partial or full matching, and you can figure out hierarchies and reason about types and other things like that within a system. Much better than you could if you didn't have those in the first place. You would have to spend a lot more boilerplate, a lot more code in general, just to get the same kind of functionality. So, already been talking about it, but functional programming, just want to reiterate, that brings a lot more of algebraic set theory, a lot more data types. They're a little bit more on the exotic level, but are a lot more math oriented, which gives you a lot of neat features like formal verification and everything else I've already said pretty much, but I'm gonna get a little bit more into some other reasons that functional programming is very nice. And then I also specifically wanted to point out the Akka actor model. It's a library written in Scala, built for the JVM and Java and Scala specifically. It's a way of passing messages around a system and creating components that can keep their own state while also interacting with other components, but not creating issues with synchronicity or anything like that. So as an example of the concise code part, so here is a little bit of an exaggerated example of Java. So this is basically, just a public class person with two private variables. And this is all the getters and setters and equals and two string methods that you would usually implement in a normal Java class. This is what they teach you to do in college and school and stuff like that. So you can see that's 45 lines of code just to implement all this. Now in Scala's case, with case classes, you can do all this in one line of code, automatically. All of those functions are still there. You can still call them. but due to the strong typing system involved with functional programming and case classes themselves, you can actually reason about them pretty easily, and you can use a lot of the methods that you normally have to explicitly type out in a system that doesn't have such a strong typing system. So I'd also like to talk about lines of code. Now, this is not a great metric for saying whether a code base is good or bad, or readable or easy to test on or anything like that. Now, these might be a little bit outdated by this point, and it's a little bit hard to figure out lines of code since there's all these different environments you have to build on top of and stuff like that. So these may be a little bit outdated from the sources I could find, but ours particularly is 14,000 lines of code written in Scala. Bitcoin is at least 100,000 lines of code in C++. Ethereum in the Java implementation, I'm not sure about Go, but Java itself is at least 55,000 lines of code. Now, I said that was a poor metric, but you can still reason some things about that. If you're trying to implement a framework or implement something on top of any one of these three, you're going to have to read through those lines of code to figure out what the hell you're doing. You're going to have to read through all that source code to try and find answers to questions you may have, and to test on top of that. Now, that's a little bit difficult if you have to read through hundreds of thousands of lines of code in a language you may not even be familiar with to start with, just to build an application on top of it. So, back to the concise modular thing again. Less code equals less bugs. If you're writing less code, there's just going to be less bugs. That's a pretty set standard. There's obviously, in different situations, different environments, it could be a little bit different, but in general, if you're writing less code, there's less bugs to be had. It's easier to test. If you only have, two files to test with, 100 lines of code in each, that's a lot easier than having, eight different files that all have to link together and create different hierarchies and different unit tests for each one and stuff like that. And the component architecture. So this isn't really specific to Scala or anything like that. It's more of a design choice for the ScoreX framework that we carried over into Edda on top of the Scala. So since everything has such a strong typing system with Scala itself, you can really create a hierarchy of different types of models and classes in the system, and just by doing that, you can actually eliminate a whole class of bugs because you, based on the typing alone, you actually can't even compile the code if the typing isn't exactly 100% correct every single time. If there's any ambiguity in the typing, the code will not even compile at all. So you have to have that strong typing in place to reason about hierarchies and polymorphism within functional programming like this. And this is just for Scala and Haskell and the strongly typed systems. Of course, there's Clojure and the other ones where Lisp, where there's no typing at all, and people, there's reasons to use both. So, yes, I've been harping on a strong typing system. That's why it is number one up there on the list. Another thing is pure functions. So, along with the immutable values, so a key component of all blockchains is their immutability, which goes hand in hand with functional programming. All of the collections classes, all of the data structures used in functional program are by nature immutable. If you create a variable x equals 1 in any functional programming language, that x is always going to equal 1 no matter what for the life cycle of the program. So, in essence, a blockchain is considered a deterministic finite state machine. That means you have to be able to see to the very end of the code exactly how that code is going to run. And when you create data structures, if they're mutable and they can change in the middle of runtime, that's not very good, that's not very safe for something like a blockchain, where something could change, you know, something can't change in a blockchain. And if it does, you break the entire chain. So this leads to a very easy and very high concurrency and parallelism, since you don't have to worry about things changing in the middle of using them. You can send them flying around the system back and forth, knowing that whatever state they end up in is something that was by design. There's no, and going back to the pure functions, and pure functions, for anybody that doesn't know, that means there's no side effects. So if you write a function in a functional programming language and it's a pure function, that means whatever input you give it will equal the same output every single time. There is no point where you could put the same input and get a different answer. So the easiest way to think about it is, in fact, the opposite, is how would you get a non-pure function? I/O, input output. So there's a reason that smart contracts do not allow you to do things like Ethereum specifically. They don't allow you to make calls outside of the contract to like a website or something like that, because that's I/O. You don't know what you're going to get back from that website. You could get, you know, a 404 error, you could get some other resource, you could get something completely different because somebody's changing the endpoint on the other end. And by nature, blockchains are finite state machines. They're deterministic. They need to be able to take the same input and come out with the same output, because every node has to have the same answer or you break consensus. So, functional programming by design has pure functions built in as a core piece of architecture. Pairs very well with blockchains. And then higher order functions. So, in the I/O case, higher order function is basically, you can think of it as like a wrapper around an answer. So, let's say you ask, you send, you know, an HTTP request to a website somewhere, and you are expecting to get back an answer, but you're not sure what you're going to get back because you're not sure if that website's even up at this point in time. You may not get back an answer at all. So you have to handle that gracefully. You have to handle that failure gracefully. You don't want to just crash your entire system. You want to be able to do something else, you know, return an error, but then still continue on with the rest of your system. So in JavaScript, you have things like promises, and Scala, you have futures, and they're implementing that in JavaScript too, where you wrap these calls in some higher order function that when it returns, you can decide with the rest of the program what to do with it, instead of just storing an error and then crashing the entire system on top of you. So Scala being on the JVM, there's also multiple benefits there. So I do know that I put tools on here twice. I'm going to get into the reason why. So first, tools. Tooling is a very important thing that I think a lot of people kind of forget about sometimes. When you are trying to actually run code and you're trying to deploy it onto multiple, you know, instances on AWS, or trying to run a continuous integration environment, or trying to, you know, just compile the thing, you know, five times a minute because you're changing one variable over and over and over to see what happens. You know, if it takes you 5 minutes to compile every time, that's just not worth it. So you can actually tweak a lot of things in the JVM, garbage collection and compiling, and Scala actually has a quite fast compile system due to the way the strong typing system works when it comes to runtime errors. So tooling is very important. If it takes you a long time to do anything, and you have to multiply that out every single time you do it, tons of times, you know, you're wasting a lot of time where you could be coding, you could be actually working on the system, and you're fighting your environment just to get something done. So the other nice thing about Scala is it's not just strictly functional. It has access to Java libraries, Java tools, has access to, you know, Gradle and Maven, has access to everything Java has. It's basically a superset. By default, you should use Scala in a, not should, you want to use Scala in a functional setting since that's its core architecture. But you can definitely add in mutable states, mutable functions, right alongside regular functional Scala code, which is a nice thing if you really need to break that functional programming for some good reason that you may have. Which leads to the next thing, mix of functional object oriented. So you have, you know, your functions, you can compose them, you can curry them, you can do all your fun functional things alongside regular object-oriented class and polymorphic architecture. You can build in both. You can have, if you have good reasons for using one over the other, you can have that in the same program. And JVM, it runs practically anywhere. I mean, you can run it on embedded, you can run it on mobiles, which is very good for Topple. You know, we're going to be testing this out in, you know, remote regions in Africa and Colombia, where they don't really have access to, you know, high-powered desktops or even laptops. You know, 90% of the people out there are probably running around with just a regular phone and want to actually run these things. So back to tools again. I really think that tools are a huge point that people just gloss over. Scala actually is mainly used through IntelliJ, the IDE. I'm actually a Vim person myself, but I choose to use IntelliJ over that because with the strong typing system and the composable functions, autocomplete is a very nice thing, and having something there that can check your typing system as you're writing it is very important. You know, it's Scala is a scripting language as much as it is a compilable language, but in our case, you know, we're always compiling it, we're running nodes, we want to be able to deploy nodes continuously and fast. We want to be able to, you know, deploy it to AWS immediately. We want to be able to run builds on site or remotely and check that everything is running concurrently, running together, all the nodes are interacting properly, and we have a lot of testing environments and tools set up to check all that. A lot of it through the JVM, actually. And it's a very nice thing to have that if you're coming from, well, JavaScript's getting better, but if you're coming from something that doesn't have a as nice of a tooling situation, that's one of the reasons people point to Haskell is not really having as much of a strong market presence, because the tooling system has not been worked out as well as some of these tools have. Java had years and years, millions of dollars, Oracle behind it to create a bunch of great tools, and Scala just built right on top of those. So Scala comes complete with a bunch of Java tools that have been well tested and used in enterprise level environments, and it's a great thing to have. So then Akka specifically. Like I said, it's a library built into Scala and Java. It's a great thing to have. The nice thing about it is it's really for message passaging. It's you can create these actors within a system that hold their own state. So you can have an actor over here and an actor over there. And they both are working under their own state and sending messages back and forth in an asynchronous fashion. So the nice thing is you can swap out these actors. You can drop them. You can do different things, mutate them how you want, and all you're really doing is breaking the pathway between them. You're not actually affecting the other actor itself. So it makes it much easier to create highly modular systems where all these actors are acting independently of each other and just passing messages back and forth, but still creating a seamless transition as you move through the different states, which
which is very important in a distributed system like a blockchain. This creates a very high, fault tolerant and concurrent system that is very hard to break in any networking scheme. I think Apache Spark is moving away from it, but for a long time, Apache Spark used Akka for the distributed systems, and it works very well in that kind of environment. So it pairs very well with blockchains. So now to the actual blockchain example. So this is a little bit of our framework, Topple/ETA, where we started implementing some of our smart contracts and testing them out and stuff like this. So in our case, our smart contracts are just written in plain old JavaScript. So this is what you would see on the Solidity side, basically. This is comparable to how Solidity would be. But then this is more like the ABI part, where after you write in the JavaScript, it creates a JSON resource that gets passed around through the system. So I wanted to point out a couple of things. This is for a specific type of contract that we have in our system for a profit sharing agreement. It's a very simple contract. If you ever see this again, it's probably going to look a lot more complex. But a couple of key things I want to point out was in our system, we have implemented at the protocol level this idea of parties. So you have parties entering into contracts with different roles. So these roles are actually well-defined within the system. If you're an investor, a hub, or a producer, there's actually very specific behavior involved with you declaring yourself as one of these roles. There's real penalties and real rewards for declaring yourself a certain role in a certain type of contract. And this is in a supply chain type situation. So the hub is actually supposed to be a physical hub that is receiving the assets that's to be tokenized through this system. So down here you have asset code of wheat. So that is what the hub should be receiving. It should be receiving units of wheat, whatever they declare, whatever they decide on in the contract, and through non-blockchain means on top of that. We are working on building out identity solutions and a messaging system on top of this to handle this outside of just the contracts themselves, to actually do the sourcing and settlements and stuff like that. This is also built at the protocol level. When you declare an asset code of wheat, you're creating real asset tokens that have that type. And you see right there, it says pledge of 100. So basically in this contract, the pledge is the producer is going to create 100 units of wheat. And right below it, there's this thing called X-rate. So the investor is basically taking, they are saying we're pledging a certain amount of tokens at a rate of 1.5 tokens for every one unit of wheat. So in our case, we're creating a stable coin called Polys and Topples situation. That could look that way for somebody using sidechain to implement Ethereum, where you can actually use Ether in these contracts. So you could say it's 1.5 Ether for every unit of wheat. But every time the producer brings any shipment of wheat, they're going to receive 1.5 tokens for every unit they bring. And then the profit from selling the wheat after the fact through the hub is going to happen right there, where you see that function type, piecewise, linear, multiple points, and all that. So basically all that's saying is the profits are going to be divided evenly into thirds between the three parties in the contract. So it's a pretty simple contract. Our parser is still being built out. We're building it for different use cases. This is an older type of contract that is probably going to change very rapidly over the next couple of months as we lead up to our mainnet launch for Topple. And by extension, ETA is going to change also. This is what a basic framework for a contract type system would look like, where you just can create new contracts. You can, if you click on this box right here, you can fill out, you know, it will expand, it will get bigger than that, believe me. There's no way you're coding in a box that small. But you're writing your actual contract agreements where all the parties come together and figure out what they actually want to create as far as assets go and what they want to do with the contract. Above it, you can see you can add parties to the contract through there. That's part of the messaging system we're building out, where you can add and remove parties through the GUI to contracts seamlessly. So in this case, we were going to run a live demo where you would actually create the contract. I'd ask you guys for, you know, an asset, but we were worried about time and all that. So,
it might break this.
This is the actual test net running right now. It's a lot of just debugging type, you know, messages to make sure that it's actually connecting to certain nodes and stuff like that. But this is what you would expect to see from a framework type level implementation, where this is the actual code, this is the bare metal running, and it's just giving you only the information that you really need to build on top of it. So this is our current test net for the ETA framework. I didn't have much more to say. This is basically just pointing out if we had actually ran the contracts, basically what would happen is it would update, and since it's a mutable data structure built within, you know, this functional programming, you're actually creating an entirely new contract every time you update this contract. So it'd be updated, let's say, you know, they had the pledge, it decremented to 50 because they brought in a shipment. So then the contract itself handles the transactions to split the profits and split and give the producer the currency that was promised, that was locked up in the contract when it was created. So in conclusion, Scala provides numerous business and technology advantages to blockchain specifically, due to the way its fundamental architecture and functional programming allows. And application-specific permissionless blockchains are a secure and scalable solution with a wide range of applicability. So that was one very basic use case of some very simple contract that we had right there, just written in JavaScript. But the idea is you can build out an entire functional parser that you can run very specific behaviors through to create very specific types of contracts, not just Ethereum type smart contracts where it's basically just a general computer, but more so, you know, non-turn complete contracts maybe that only really have one specific use case in their system that is, you know, applicable at like a business logic level. So actual businesses can use blockchains for normal business operations and not have to worry about, you know, malicious attackers or somebody writing some sort of code that's going to piggyback off their system and do something weird that they're not expecting. I'd just like to point out, it was me and Jim up here, but we also have Chris and Kim here at our conference walking around too. So if you have any questions, you know, feel free to come ask us after this. And I think we still have time for questions. Yeah, so if anybody has any questions. Yes. Okay. Yeah, so we were targeting about 5 second block times. That's highly tunable with the way Ouroboros works. Basically, we want to still achieve a very grounded finality. But we feel five second block times, us and Cardano have not had enough time to test that fully yet, but we've been talking with Charles and all of them, trying to figure that out. They, Cardano specifically will have more set parameters sometime next summer, probably. We're hoping to have a safe solution by December. So Boros Prowse, the second generation of the protocol, implemented an asynchronous scheme called verifiable secret sharing. So basically, it's a commit real scheme of the former slot election leaders. They basically pick the new slot election leaders through this election process, right? The seeds to create the pseudo-random verifiable functions. So it is pseudo-random, even though it says verifiable random function. It's verifiably random in a pseudo manner, because you just can't generate truly random functions on a computer. It's just not going to happen. But it actually uses the previous generated numbers. So there is some bootstrapping involved and stuff like that. It's a pretty, it's not well known, but it's a pretty tested theory.
I'm sure, just to maybe kind of get a little more broad overview.
The Ouroboros protocol, these epochs, the dawn of an epoch generates this random number, which kind of weights all the stakeholders, and then for each slot, there's one person elected, and they sign for that slot, they'll sign a block, and it goes for that chunk of time. The next person is the leader, and it's deterministic. It's known for that epoch who all the slot leaders are going to be. So that's all I wanted to point out, is that for in a certain epoch, you know who the slot leaders are going to be, and then when it's done, you close the epoch. That set is final, it's part of history, and then the next epoch dawns, and the next set of slot leaders are elected based on the secret kind of generated from the previous epoch. So I just wanted to expand, make sure it was clear.
Yes, you can. Yeah. Okay.
First one is about competitive data you mentioned for the tooling for the system.
Yes.
I love it too, but my experience doesn't go very well with functional programming libraries such as CAS or CAS. So I'm wondering, do you use those libraries?
Actually, we don't really use many libraries at all, besides like Okka and the crypto libraries, for creating curve signatures and stuff like that. But I actually haven't had much of a chance to mess with like Scala Z or CATS or anything like that. So I will definitely have to check that out. So that is a key point that I don't think I touched much on, but we really want it to be as accessible to everybody as possible, and JavaScript being the largest language in the world made that pretty easy. But also on top of that, we wanted to actually split the smart contract language from the blockchain language on purpose to give it, to make things a little bit easier for security reasons. We did not want any, since we are a small team, we don't have EOS's money or anything like that. We wanted to make sure that we were doing things as securely as possible, and by having two completely separate languages being used in sandbox environments, we could better reason that there would be less security holes. But yes, we actually do write our smart contracts in Scala.js sometimes, since the strong typing system is very helpful. No. basically you can build in, you know, suicide functions, you can build in basically anything that you would see like in Ethereum or something like that. Nature, it's immutable, so if it already exists, unless you catch it before something happens, if it happens, you can't roll back the system. Unless, you know, you actually, I mean, we are talking about, you know, running your own chain and stuff like that. You could totally hard fork your own chain and just go to the new one and pretend like that never happened or something for personal use. But yeah, in a normal environment, you would just have to foresee something like that happening and be able to build like a suicide function or something to prevent that from happening, I guess. JavaScript is also functional, so you can definitely build in some little bit of a formal verification and stuff like that to try and reason about things. You got a question?
Yes. Can you talk a little
bit
more about the
epochs? Okay. So that's also a tunable thing. It's to help with the block times, since you want that finality. It was based on, I don't remember the numbers off the top of my head necessarily, since they all are very changeable, but it was basically to give like 5 to 10 second block times with about 2 hours of finality at the latest. So you would finalize this epoch and it would, everything that happened in that epoch is completely final. You cannot go back and change it. You don't have to wait for multiple confirmations, multiple epochs. So there's actually, I'm trying to remember. there's a lot of numbers involved with Ouroboros, so. we may change that depending on what we see in our system. Yeah, so before the epochs end, it's just like blocks. It's just regular blocks, so they can be, you know, uncle chains can be written off, you know. It's just like normal, what you would see in Ethereum or proof of work.
I think it's really to have a one problem that kind of arises with other state is
that you it's not like very deterministic what your finality time is going to be. So the epoch provides that determinicity. That's really kind of the thought behind it, is that it's a short enough time that you can say, okay, it's considered confirmed, move on.
All right, does anybody else have anything? Okay, yep. we've definitely been researching that, I believe so. Right now we are looking at a trusted solution for Ethereum specifically with our own blockchain. There's an idea called NepoPouse, non-interactive proof of work. That's a mouthful. So the idea is basically you can take the hashing of the blocks and deterministically find what are called super blocks. So you can actually you can cut down how much you would actually need to basically wrap up a large group of blocks and transactions and prove to another chain that these actually happens and you have the proof in hand and stuff like that. Only works for proof of work. I haven't solved proof of stake yet. But to answer your question more directly, since that had nothing to do with atomic swaps, so we believe we'd be able to do atomic swaps no problem. We're working on building out a decentralized exchange within our system, and atomic swaps are almost absolutely needed for that.
Let's say I run a contract and there are parties to add a party, another to the smart contract, or
So I'm actually dealing with that right now. I'm writing a contract for a group of farmers in India where they want to be able to add and remove farmers at will. So basically, it goes hand in hand with the whole immutable idea. You're creating a new contract every time you update it anyways, so it's not that big of a deal if you have to update it with new parties. Basically, the idea would be, in our system specifically, in our framework, you have every single party sign this contract. You can do it at any time you want, as long as once all parties sign, somebody that is a party of that contract can actually submit it to the blockchain. But all parties have to be involved with the signing process, and that contract has to be in the same state every time these parties sign it before it gets submitted and deployed on the blockchain. So basically what you would do is create an all-new blockchain, an all-new contract, and just take the state, the previous state of the old contract, and copy it over to the new contract with the added or removed parties. So something I didn't really talk about was we were building out a backend for message passing to handle the smart contract specifically with Matrix. For those not familiar, there is a chat client known as Matrix or Riot, which is the front end for it, but it is a federated, decentralized chat client, essentially. Status, one of the cryptocurrencies that's doing a message protocol. I actually just gave them $5 million of funding, so hopefully they can start doing some great things with that. But we were personally using it as the back end to handle message passing for creation and deploying these contracts. So the idea is to basically programmatically be able to sign contracts automatically or through just clicking a button or something like that. So abstracting away from your users. Any more questions? Okay. All right, well, thank you all very much for coming.